Good morning, students. Today we will be discussing module 3, upper extremity, bones of the upper limb. The learning objective is to understand the upper limb bones. The upper limb skeleton, it consists of scapula, clavicle, humerus, radius, ulna, carpals. In the carpals there is distal row as well as proximal row, metacarpals and phalanges, as in the diagram detected, given in the pictorial representation. The proximally it is clavicle, then scapula, then the long bone humerus, then comes two more long bone, radius and ulna, then there's this proximal carpals, that is scaphoid, lunate, cap, trapezium and pisiform. Then the distal row, that is trapezoid, triequetrum, hamate. Okay. Similarly, this is the spine of scapula, and there's this acromion process which is present. Then there is olecranon process. This view is the posterior view, and this is the anterior view. In the anterior view, in the scapula, there is superior angle. Then there is coracoid process, there is acromion process, there is glenoid cavity. Then in the humerus, there is greater tubercle, lesser tubercle, and then there is inferior angle. Then in the humerus, you can see medial condyle and the lateral condyle. Then this radius and ulna. Only ulnar side, you can see the head of the ulna being attached to the radius, and the head of the radius is proximally near to the elbow joint, whereas head of ulna is near to the wrist joint. What are the bones of the upper limb? Number one is scapula. In the A position, it is the anterior aspect of the scapula, which has superior angle, superior border, scapular notch, subscapular fossa, medial border, inferior angle, lateral border, glenoid fossa, supraglenoid tubercle, coracoid process and acromion process. Whereas when we see posteriorly, we can see acromion process, coracoid process, scapular notch, glenoid fossa, infraglenoid tubercle, infraspinous fossa, lateral border, medial border, spine, supraspinous fossa, superior border and superior angle. Then next is the clavicle. Clavicle is also known as the collarbone. It has two surfaces, inferior surface and the superior surface. Two parts, anterior part and the posterior part. It has sternal extremity and the acromial extremity. The sternal extremity gives an attachment to the axial skeleton, whereas the acromial extremity gives an attachment to the appendicular skeleton. Then if we see the inferior surface, in the inferior surface, there are attachments like trapezoid line, conicoid tubercle, groove for subclavius muscle. And there is impression for costoclavicular ligament or costal tubercle. Next comes the humerus. The humerus has two aspects, anterior aspect and the posterior aspect. In the anterior aspect, we can see the humeral head, the anatomical neck, greater tuberosity, surgical neck, lesser tuberosity, lateral epicondyle, medial epicondyle, coronoid fossa, ulnar nerve groove, humeral trochlea and humeral capsulum. Whereas in posterior aspect, we can only see humeral head, anatomical neck, greater tuberosity, lateral condyle, olecranon fossa and humeral trochlea, as well as medial epicondyle and ulnar nerve groove. Next comes the radius and the ulna. In the anterior view, we can see radial notch, olecranon process, trochlear notch, head, neck, radial tuberosity, coronoid process, proximal radio ulnar joint, interosseous membrane, radius, ulnar notch, head of ulna, styloid process of ulna, distal radio ulnar joint and styloid process of radius. In the posterior aspect, we can see the olecranon process, head of radius, neck of radius, interosseous membrane, ulna, radius, styloid process of radius. Then comes the bones of the hand. In the proximal, this is the anterior view of left hand, this is posterior view of the left hand. In the posterior view, in the anterior view of the left hand, we can see scaphoid, then lunate, then triequetrum and pisiform. So it is she looks too pretty. This is for the proximal row of carpals. And for the distal row of carpals, it is trapezium, trapezoid, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. So the mnemonic is try to catch her. So it is she looks too pretty, try to catch her. From the proximal to the distal, going from the radial end to the ulnar end. Okay. So it is scaphoid, lunate, triquetrum, pisiform, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. Okay. Then we have metacarpals 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. They are numbered like that. It has three parts: head, shaft, and base. Then we have phalanges, proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and distal phalanx. So they are 14 in each hand. Next is the joints of the upper limb. There is a shoulder joint, arm, forearm, and wrist. The shoulder girdle consists of sternoclavicular, acromioclavicular. In the arm, it is glenohumeral joint. And in the forearm, it is humeroradial joint, humeroulnar joint, proximal radioulnar joint, and distal radioulnar joint. Whereas in wrist and hand, there is intercarpal joint, carpometacarpal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint, and interphalangeal joint. Now, the bones and joints of upper limb. See, in the shoulder girdle, the bones are clavicle and scapula. The joints are sternoclavicular and acromioclavicular. In the bone of arm, the bone is known as humerus. The upper end is glenohumeral joint. Lower end we will discuss in bone of forearm. In the bone of forearm, there is radius and ulna. Joints are humeroradial, humeroulnar, proximal radioulnar, and distal radioulnar. In bones of wrist and hand, there are 8 carpal bones, 5 metacarpal, and 14 phalanges. Joints are intercarpal, carpometacarpal, metacarpophalangeal, and interphalangeal joint. The learning outcome is to apply the concept of the upper limb, bone, and joints. Thank you.